for us today and their continued service to our nation. It's been 1 year. It's been 1 year since President Obama spoke to the nation about the threat posed by ISIL and increased U.S. military operations against us. Many of us believe that the goal the President laid out, quote, to degrade and ultimately destroy ISIL, is right. Many of us agree with a military strategy that seeks to empower local forces in Iraq and Syria to combat ISIL with U.S. and coalition training, equipment, assistance, and air power. 1 year into this campaign, it seems impossible to assert that ISIL is losing and that we are winning. And if you're not winning in this kind of warfare, you are losing. Stalemate is not success. It is accurate that we have conducted thousands of airstrikes against ISIL, trucks and fighters, bunkers and buildings. This conjures the illusion of progress, but what effect has that had? ISIL has lost some territory on the margin, mainly to Kurdish and Shiite forces, but ISIL has consolidated control of its core territories and expanded its control in Syria. It continues to dominate Sunni Arab areas in both Iraq and Syria. It maintains control of key cities like Mosul, Fallujah, and Ramadi, and efforts to retake those territories appear to have stalled entirely. Meanwhile, ISIL is expanding globally. It's now operating in Afghanistan, Yemen, Libya, and Egypt, and other radical Islamic groups like Boko Haram in Nigeria and al-Shabaab in Somalia have pledged allegiance to ISIL. This appearance of success only enhances ISIL's ability to radicalize, recruit, and grow. Published media reports suggest that the CIA's estimates of ISIL's manpower has remained constant, despite U.S. airstrikes, which suggests that either they were wrong to begin with or that ISIL is replacing its losses in real time. Neither is good. Indeed, this committee is disturbed by recent whistleblower allegations that officials at Central Command skewed intelligence assessments to paint an overly positive picture of conditions on the ground. We are currently investigating these allegations, which we take with the utmost seriousness. The Department of Defense should as well. And if true, those responsible must be held accountable. Ultimately, it's not that we are doing nothing to counter ISIL. It is that there is no compelling reason to believe that anything we are currently doing will be sufficient to achieve our strategic objective of degrading and ultimately destroying ISIL. The United States and our partners do not have the initiative. Our enemies do. They're capitalizing on our inadequate policy to maintain and enhance their initiative as they have for the past 4 years. Indeed, the situation on the ground is now taking yet another dramatic turn for the worse, as several recent events make clear. Recent published reports state that U.S. officials believe that ISIL is using mustard gas and may even be manufacturing these chemical weapons by themselves. Whether ISIL is manufacturing chemical weapons themselves or acquired from former or current stocks maintained by Bashar Assad, this is a potential nightmare scenario for our partners in the Middle East and for us. At the same time, the United States' effort to train and equip Syrian rebels to fight ISIL is clearly and unfortunately failing. The goal was 3,000 fighters in the first year. Instead, this program has trained and equipped only 54 fighters, some of whom were killed or captured by al-Qaeda as soon as they returned to Syria. This program, the administration promised, would result in a viable indigenous ground force in Syria, has yet to produce any significant effects on the battlefield. To be sure, fixation with perfect vetting, both in the Congress and the administration, is contributing to this failure. But far worse has been the administration's requirement that this new Syrian force could only fight ISIL, not the Assad regime, which has killed far more Syrians than ISIL, and the President's refusal until just weeks ago to authorize the close air support and other military assistance to ensure our Syrian partners would be successful. Unfortunately, these contradictions were clear from the beginning, and many members of this committee warned the administration to change course. Their failure to do so has squandered a lot of time, money, and worst of all, credibility. For this committee to continue supporting this program, we need some major changes. Into this vacuum has now stepped Vladimir Putin. As in Ukraine and elsewhere, he perceives the administration's inaction and caution as weakness, and he is taking advantage. According to media reports, Putin has deployed strike aircraft, T-90 tanks, howitzers, armored personnel carriers, Russian Marines, and housing for up to 1,500 personnel in military bases in western Syria. This is an expansion of Russian power in the Middle East that we have not seen in four decades. And it will allow Putin to further prop up Assad, fuel his indiscriminate killing machine, play kingmaker in any transition, undermine U.S. goals, policy, and operations, and ultimately prolong this horrific conflict. The main beneficiary will be ISIL. Many of us have said from the beginning that the conflict in Syria would not be contained, and for 4 years we have seen evidence of that, the hundreds of thousands dead, the millions of driven and displaced people, the use of chemical weapons, and the rise of the worst terrorist army in the world. Now we are seeing the latest manifestation of this failed policy, the flood of people pouring out of the Middle East that has led to the worst refugee crisis in Europe since World War II. The administration has promised to accept 10,000 refugees in the coming year. That's a noble gesture. But unless we address the cause of this crisis, which is the continued grinding conflict in Syria, the refugees will keep coming. ISIL will grow stronger, the Middle East will descend further into chaos, and U.S. national security interests will be put at greater risk. For 4 years, we have been told that there is no military solution to this conflict, as if anyone believes there is, and there are no good options, as if anybody believes there are, that our influence is limited, as if that has not always been the case, that we will not succeed overnight, as if our problem is one of time, not policy, and that we cannot solve every problem in the Middle East, as if that absolves us of our responsibility to make the situation better where we can. This is not a question of our capacity or our capabilities or our options. We have options between doing nothing and evading Iraq and Syria. Many members of this committee have suggested such options for years now, and they are still relevant. We need to put an end to Assad's ability to use air power against his people, especially the use of horrific barrel bombs. Shoot down planes that drop barrel bombs that slaughter innocent civilians. It's one of the leading killers of innocent civilians. We need to help establish safe zones inside Syria where refugees and displaced people can be secure. We need forward air controllers to add precision and lethality to our air campaign. We need to make significant changes in order to improve and rapidly expand our training of Syrian and Iraqi forces. And while no one believes that we need to invade Iraq or Syria, the fact is that we will likely need additional U.S. special forces and military advisors to be successful. I hope our witnesses will not repeat our desired policy goals and a list of tactical achievements and talk about, quote, 9 lines of effort. We have heard all of that before, but we have yet to hear a theory of victory. I hope to hear one today. Senator Reid.
Well, thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, Ms. Secretary Wormuth, and General Austin, welcome. This morning's hearing continues the committee's review of U.S. military operations to counter ISIL in Iraq and Syria and its growth in the broader Middle East, Africa, and South Asia. Through its extreme ideological and brutal tactics, including the reported development and use of chemical weapons, ISIL has gained control over portions of Syria and Iraq, effectively erasing the border between these countries. This violent extremist group has slaughtered civilians, enslaved women and girls, and carried out horrific attacks against ethnic and religious minorities, and broadcast its barbaric acts on social media. To escape the violence of ISIL, the Assad regime, and multiple other armed elements, millions have been displaced or fled outside Iraq and Syria. The crush of fleeing refugees into Europe has only added to the sense of urgency regarding the need to restore security in the region. The military campaign against ISIL remains complex with no easy answers. While the coalition has had success in pushing ISIL out of some territory, including gains by the Kurdish Peshmerga in the north, the retaking of Tikrit by Iraqi security forces, and the Syrian Kurds' removal of ISIL along sections of the border with Turkey, the self-described Islamic State continues to hold key cities, including Al-Raqqa in Syria and Mosul in Iraq. The Iraq Security Force's counteroffensive to take back Ramadi has struggled over the last few months, and Baji remains contested. At the same time, Iranian-backed Shia militias have stalled in their operations near Fallujah. And despite its recent setbacks, ISIL is consolidating its control over local populations in the areas that it holds in both Syria and Iraq. The recent agreement between the United States and Turkey, expanding access to land and use of Turkish air bases, and seeking to create an ISIL-free zone on the Syrian side of the border, is an important step forward. However, the provocative deployments by Russia of additional military forces to bases in Syria under the guise of assisting in countering ISIL efforts appears to be an effort by Putin to prop up the Assad regime, further complicating efforts to restore security in Syria. These events have raised concerns over whether the current level of our efforts against ISIL is sufficient. A critical issue for the military lines of effort within the counter-ISIL strategy is the progress of the U.S. train and equip programs for coalition-backed forces in both Iraq and Syria. While the U.S.-led air campaign has had an effect in degrading ISIL, effective local forces that can take full advantage of coalition air power, seize ground from ISIL, and then hold it are essential to success. In Iraq, operations to take Anbar require recruiting significant numbers of Sunnis into the Iraqi security forces and equipping them to resist the ISIL threat. I am concerned by reports that Sunni recruitment has fallen short of its targets and that the government of Iraq has been slow in delivering equipment for arming Sunni forces. In Syria, the DOD Syria Train and Equip Program, according to public reports, has experienced a variety of setbacks. We'll be interested in your assessment of this effort, quite interested. In general, I also hope you will address what you believe might be done to intensify our military operations to counter the ISIL threat. For example, would you support a more active role for U.S. military personnel in facilitating the engagement with Sunni tribes, or providing advisors within the Iraqi Ministry of Defense to build institutional capacity, or accompanying Iraqi security forces on a limited basis when direct contact with enemy is not anticipated? The ISIL problem is not geographically bounded by Syria and Iraq. And indeed, as the Chairman has pointed out, ISIL-inspired or directed groups have appeared in Yemen, Afghanistan, Egypt, Libya, Nigeria, the Horn of Africa, and the Caucasus, and elsewhere. General, I am interested in your assessment of the group's growth in the region and how CENTCOM is contributing to trans-regional efforts to combat the group. Ultimately, the success of the counter-ISIL effort will depend on a number of non-military factors also, including whether the reforms Prime Minister Abadi has initiated are implemented and result in an Iraqi government that is more inclusive and responsive to the concerns of the Sunnis, Kurds, religious minorities, and other factions in Iraq society, whether the international coalition, including states in the region, can effectively counter ISIL's propaganda, financing, and the spread of its extreme ideology, and whether a political solution can be found for the crisis in Syria. These issues are the primary responsibility of departments other than the Department of Defense, but I assume our witnesses would agree that these issues are integral to our comprehensive approach to countering the ISIL threat. General Austin, I hope that you will also, to the extent possible, given the ongoing review by the Inspector General, address questions involving intelligence assessments with respect to ISIL. It is important that we wait for the Inspector General's investigation before completed, before making a judgment, but I have no doubt you will take such allegations as seriously as we do in Congress, and we take them very seriously. Like Senator McCain, I expect the committee will be kept apprised of this investigation as it continues and be active in terms of the recommendations. Let me thank both witnesses for the testimony this morning. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Ms. Wormuth.
Thank you, Chairman McCain and Ranking Member Reed, as well as members of the committee. Thank you for the opportunity to be here today to give you an update on the military aspects of our counter-ISIL campaign. It's also a pleasure, as always, to be here with General Austin. We work very closely together every day on a range of issues, so it's nice to be here with him today. As the Chairman said, it's been just over a year since the United States and a coalition of nations began the military campaign against ISIL. When we began that campaign about a year ago, ISIL was pushing into Kurdish territory in northern Iraq and pushing towards Baghdad. Over the past 12 months, ISIL has lost territory in both Syria and Iraq, despite advances it's made in Ramadi and Palmyra. Progress has been slow but steady. There have definitely been setbacks in the past year. While not 10 feet tall, ISIL remains a thinking enemy that adapts to evolving conditions on the battlefield. Our train and equip programs in Iraq and Syria have faced challenges. In Iraq, the pace of our program has moved more slowly than we'd like. And in Syria, the stringent vetting criteria we're using at the outset of the program has contributed to smaller numbers than we'd hoped for. As the military campaign continues in both countries, we expect there will continue to be challenges clearing and holding territory. But we've also seen progress in the past year. You're all familiar with the successful operations to take back Kurdish territory in Iraq, to defeat ISIL in Kobani, and to more recently retake Tikrit, as well as other successful engagements. On the political front, Prime Minister Abadi continues to demonstrate the resolve necessary to confront ISIL, and he is striving to manage what is a very difficult political landscape in Baghdad. In Syria, we've seen some opportunities emerge that we didn't envision a year ago, particularly in the northern part of the country, where Syrian Kurds working with Syrian Arabs have successfully pressured ISIL along the Turkish border. Over a year ago, the president outlined a whole-of-government strategy to degrade and ultimately defeat ISIL, and he emphasized it would be a multi-year campaign. When Secretary Carter was here in July, he outlined the 9 lines of effort that comprise our strategy. But I would emphasize it will take more than the military campaign to be successful. We also need to dry up ISIL's finances. We need to stop the flow of foreign fighters into Iraq and Syria in particular, protect the United States from potential attacks from ISIL, provide humanitarian assistance in areas that we are taking back from ISIL, and find a way to more effectively counter ISIL's very successful messaging campaign. As Secretary Carter said to the committee in July, the administration believes we have the right strategy in place. We're now focused on implementing the strategy as effectively as possible. This is a very much an interagency effort with increasingly better synchronization across all of the departments and agencies that are involved. And in fact, Secretary Carter and Secretary Kerry have been meeting together with their senior staffs to monitor and identify issues in the campaign, and they're meeting tomorrow with NCTC to focus in particular on foreign fighters. DOD, as you know, is responsible for 2 of the lines of effort inside the strategy, denying ISIL safe haven and building partner capacity. So I'd like to just speak briefly to those areas, and General Austin will also elaborate. The coalition campaign has degraded ISIL's military capacity, has removed some of its key leaders, and enabled some gains by local forces in Iraq and Syria. The ISF has regained control of Tikrit from ISIL earlier this year, and Syrian Kurds and Sunni Arab partners have recently taken the key border town in Syria of Tal Abyad, which severed one of ISIL's key lines of communication and supply and put ISIL on the defensive and also put more pressure on its stronghold Raqqa in Syria. These examples demonstrate how when we have credible ground forces and we support them with our air power, ISIL can suffer. We're also working hard to build the capacity of our partner forces on the ground. Since we began our efforts, we've now trained and equipped more than 6 brigades and provided training to more than 13,000 Iraqi personnel, Iraqi Army, Kurdish Peshmerga, and counterterrorism service personnel, and we have more in the pipeline. As Secretary Carter said in July, however, training for the Iraqi Army has been slowed by a lack of trainees coming into the training sites. Over the last several weeks, we've had better participation from Iraqi units at the training sites, and Iraq has actually expanded the pool of units that are eligible for training. Some of the units we've trained are now participating more directly in the fight in areas such as Ramadi. And early indications are that they are performing well in combat missions, but as you all know, they face a difficult fight ahead, and strong leadership of these forces is going to be essential. Our forces on the ground at Al-Asad and Takadum air bases are involved in advising and training Sunni tribal fighters in Anbar province, both through providing direct training and also through train-the-trainer type of assistance with the Iraqi security forces. And in terms of equipping these Sunni tribal fighters, we've recently delivered a battalion's worth of equipment to Iraqi officials working with us there on those 2 air bases to distribute the equipment to fighters. We're also now overseeing the distribution of the government of Iraq's equipment to these Sunni tribal fighters from these bases. So through these kinds of efforts, we now have more than 4,000 Sunni tribal fighters in Anbar province. We're also still in the early stages of our train and equip program in Syria. This effort, I think it's important to highlight, is just one element of what we're trying to do in the larger campaign in Syria, which includes an increasing number of airstrikes, as well as supporting partner forces on the ground, like the Syrian Kurds, the YPG, Sunni Arabs, and other local forces such as Turkmens, for example, to try to put pressure on ISIL in northeastern Syria. These efforts have substantially rolled ISIL back in this area and have had significant impacts on ISIL's freedom of movement and supply lines. As of September 15th, our train and equip program, the specific program we have, we're now currently training more than 100 fighters, and we have additional recruits in the pipeline. This number is definitely smaller than we'd hoped for, in part because, as the chairman and others have noted, we put our trainees through a very rigorous screening process to meet standards that are very appropriately laid out in U.S. law. We've closely aligned all of our efforts in all of these areas with our 62-country coalition. And as an example of how we're doing that, Turkey's recent decision to provide us access to bases at Incirlik and elsewhere has enabled us to expand the fight and is strengthening the cohesion of our efforts in Syria. Before turning to General Austin, I want to address Russia's involvement in Syria. We're closely tracking Russia's recent efforts to deploy additional military equipment and personnel to Syria, and we're in close touch with our allies and partners about these developments. Both Russia and Iran have continued to support politically and militarily the Assad regime, which has systematically murdered its own people and helped create the conditions of the current conflict and the rise of ISIL. What we need in Syria urgently is a political solution to the conflict through a transition away from Assad. And any actions that empower the regime to escalate the conflict are unwelcome and would be destabilizing and counterproductive. This is clearly a very difficult challenge that we face. We're not going to solve it quickly, but we have the right components in place to advance our objectives, and we're dynamically adjusting our campaign to a rapidly changing battlefield. Defeat against ISIL is going to require continued commitment, strong leadership from us and the global coalition, as well as commitment and sacrifice from local forces in Iraq and Syria. Thank you.
Good morning, Chairman McCain, Senator Reid, and distinguished members of the committee. I want to thank you for the opportunity to appear here today to provide a current update on the progress achieved over the past year in support of the ongoing campaign to counter ISIL or Daesh in Iraq and Syria. I'm pleased to appear here this morning alongside Ms. Christine Wormuth. Ms. Wormuth is widely respected throughout the Department of Defense, and we are most grateful to her for her continued and strong support of our efforts at CENTCOM. I'll join Christine in making a few brief opening comments, and then we're prepared to answer your questions. Before providing a brief update on the counter-ISIL campaign, I did want to quickly address an important issue. As the chairman mentioned, there is an ongoing DOD IG investigation looking into allegations concerning the processing of intelligence information by CENTCOM's intelligence directorate. Because the allegations are currently under investigation, it would be premature and inappropriate for me to discuss this matter. What I will say is I welcome the DOD IG's oversight. And once the investigation is complete, based upon the findings, you can be assured that I will take appropriate actions. Again, I cannot speak to the specifics of the allegations. However, I would like to take this opportunity to provide some clarity with respect to how we use intelligence products and the critical work that we do. Because of the nature of our mission at CENTCOM, we do have and rely on a robust intelligence enterprise to support the command. There are over 1,200 seasoned intelligence professionals that make up that enterprise, and they do exceptional work. And as a commander, I greatly value and seek their input and insights. I use the assessments that they provide me to, together with the inputs that I receive from a variety of sources that include my commanders on the ground, who I talk to almost every single day, and I consider this broad range of inputs when making my decisions. You know, there's been a lot of speculation in the media about the allegations made to the DOD IG, and one in particular I believe should be addressed and corrected for the record. Some have expressed concern that CENTCOM intelligence reports are sent directly to the President. This is not accurate. As the Office of the Director of National Intelligence put out to the media last week, and I quote, none of the combatant commands are permitted to engage directly in the President's daily brief process. Rather, reports are produced by the combatant commands and funneled through the DIA to ensure that all substantive deliberations and final contributions are appropriately coordinated, end of quote. Again, I cannot comment on the specific allegations. We will need to wait for the DODIG to complete its investigation. But I did want to provide this additional clarification. Ladies and gentlemen, with respect to the ongoing operations in Iraq and Syria today, despite some slow movement at the tactical level, we continue to make progress across the battle space in support of the broader U.S. government strategy to degrade and ultimately defeat ISIL. Key to the enduring success of the military campaign is sustained pressure on ISIL, both from the air and on the ground. And the approach that we adopted relies on indigenous forces to create and sustain this pressure, while also curbing the flow of foreign fighters and cutting off the enemy's ability to resource himself. In recent months, Iraq's security forces have experienced some setbacks, and this is to be expected in the early stages of a fight as complex as this one. But overall, enabled by coalition airstrikes and our advise and assist in building partner capacity efforts, the Iraqis continue to make progress. In northern Iraq, the Kurdish Peshmerga have performed exceptionally well, and the Kurdish Arab coalition in northeast Syria is also achieving substantial effects. In fact, over the past several months, they've retaken more than 17,000 square kilometers of terrain from the enemy, and the effects that they have achieved serve to create significant opportunities that, if pursued, could prove devastating for the enemy. The intent of the military campaign is to degrade and ultimately defeat the enemy through our own actions and by enabling and supporting the efforts of our coalition partners and the indigenous forces in Iraq and Syria. And again, progress is being made, and this is evidenced by what we see happening in the air and on the ground in both countries. I would also point out that the progress reflects, in large part, the many contributions made by our coalition partners. The 60-plus nation coalition represents the strength of this campaign, and we remain grateful for their strong support. Success in this campaign will require the continued support of our coalition partners, along with the support of other elements of the U.S. government and the international community. More importantly, it will require that the Iraqis do what is necessary to address their political challenges, and national reconciliation is absolutely essential to the success in the counter-ISIL campaign. We said at the outset that the military campaign to counter ISIL would take time, and it will take time. And we should expect that there will be occasional setbacks along the way, particularly in the early stages. We also need to keep in mind that we are supporting and enabling this effort, and our partners, not us, are in the lead. It is taking a bit longer to get things done, but it must be this way if we are to achieve lasting and positive effects. Fortunately, amidst the many challenges that exist in Iraq and Syria, we find opportunities, and we remain confident that our actions in pursuit of these opportunities will continue to produce positive results in the coming days. Mr. Chairman, Senator Reid, members of the committee, I want to thank you once again for the strong support that you show to our service members, our civilians and their families. They are truly exceptional, and they are making important and lasting contributions to the overall effort. Again, we appreciate your support, and I look forward to answering your questions.
Well, thank you, General Austin, Ms. Wormuth. I must say I've been a member of this committee for nearly 30 years, and I have never heard testimony like this. Never. General Austin, on September 9th, 1 week ago, Chairman Dempsey, Chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, said the fight against ISIL was, quote, tactically stalemated with no, quote, dramatic gains on either side. So obviously you and the outgoing chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff have a very different view of what the situation is. And so with all this progress that you're citing, and how long do you think it's going to take for us to defeat ISIL and to restore stability in Iraq and Syria?
Sir, it will take years. And if I may...
Years, okay.
If I may comment on... the chairman's comments. As I spoke to the chairman yesterday, and we did talk about this issue, and when I went back and took a look at what he said, he also said ISIL's future is increasingly dim as more nations join the anti-ISIL effort. And although it is tactically stalemated with no dramatic gains on either side, ISIL will move at the speed of its governance, not at the speed of its military capability. And I agree with the chairman, sir, on the issue of there haven't been any dramatic gains on either side.
Dramatic? Yeah, that's different from, quote, tactically stalemated. Please, General. That's what Chairman Dempsey and Chairman Dunford said exactly the same thing. So there's clearly a disconnect between your view and that of our outgoing and incoming Chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff. So really, in your view, everything should remain as it is. For example, do you think we should have a no-fly zone in Syria?
That's a policy decision.
And would you recommend a no-fly zone in Syria?
I would not recommend it at this point, sir.
Would you, not at this point, 4 years later, would you recommend setting up a buffer zone in Syria where these refugees might be able to come and be protected from the attacks and slaughter of Bashar Assad?
It will take a ground force to be able to protect the refugees if we do
would
that,
you
sir.
Support a buffer zone which would then protect some of these refugees who are being barrel-bombed and slaughtered by Bashar Assad?
I don't see the force available to be able to protect them currently, sir, so I would not recommend it at this point in time.
So we wouldn't be able to shoot down Bashar Assad's aircraft as they barrel-bomb and slaughter innocent men, women, and children? Is that correct? We don't have the capability to protect them.
We clearly have capability, yes, sir, we do.
But you wouldn't recommend such action?
I would not recommend a buffer zone at this point, sir.
I see. So basically, General, what you're telling us is that everything's fine. As we see hundreds of thousands of refugees leave and flood Europe, as we're seeing now 250,000 Syrians slaughtered, as you see more and more Iranian control of the Shia militia, that are the only ones that are really doing the fighting besides the Peshmerga. As I say, I've never seen a hearing that is as divorced from the reality of every outside expert and what you are saying. Does the massive flow of refugees from Syria have any effect on what you think we should be doing in Syria?
Sir, I want to be clear that I believe that this is a horrible tragedy, and this is a thing that the entire international community is going to have to continue to work together on, and so there's always we would hope that as these refugees continue to be disadvantaged, that we see more countries joining in to assist in the
So you would not support a policy that would help protect these refugees from being slaughtered by Bashar Assad with his barrel bombs?
Sir, it's always in our best interest to help protect civilians, but again, I would not recommend a buffer zone at this point in time.
So everything is really going well?
No, sir, that's not.
Well, then if things aren't going well and we've had, quote, setbacks, and the chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff says it's tactically stalemated, and you think everything is going well as pursuing the strategy and tactics on the ground that we are, General Austin, I respectfully disagree. I respectfully, fundamentally disagree. This is an abject failure. The refugees are the result of it. This is a result of leaving Iraq, and you were there at the meeting when Maliki told Senator Graham and I that if the others agreed, he would agree to keep a residual force there. And we never gave him the forces that we wanted to leave behind, which then set in train the departure of U.S. completely from Iraq and set the table for the catastrophe that we are seeing. This is, as I say, I have not attended a hearing that is so grossly distorted as the view of a terrible and tragic situation as I have seen from the witnesses. And by the way, Senator Graham and I predicted every single thing that is happening now. And I predict that unless we do something different, it will remain, as General Dempsey said, stalemated, which means tragedy. Senator Reid.
Well, thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Both Madam Secretary and General Austin, about a year ago or more, there was real concern that essentially Baghdad could fall under to ISIL, that they were virtually unstoppable. And at this point, your assessment of the security, at least of the Baghdad, has that been improved?
Sir, it has been greatly improved.
And going forward now, one of the fundamental issues is, and I think it's related to the comments that both you and General Dempsey have made, is who will have the advantage going forward in terms of the use of time, ISIL or Iraqi forces supported by the United States? What's your view on that?
Sir, I think clearly it's the Iraqi forces supported by not only the United States, but the 60-plus nation coalition.
Now, one of the things that has been suggested, but not only suggested, but recommended strongly to the Iraqi government is they create a National Guard units, Sunni units as well as others, but formally allied with the government, and that legislation is bogged down in their parliament. Is that accurate?
That's correct, sir.
So we are, we could do more, essentially, if the Iraqis were willing to make some changes in terms of their policies. For example, we could at least contemplate the use of advisors with these National Guard, Iraqi National Guard units to be brokers in terms of distributing equipment as well as tactical advice. Is that something that's possible if we get cooperation?
It's clearly possible, yes, sir.
Is it something you would consider if it?
Yes, sir, it is.
Yeah. And one of the factors, too, and this is a constant source of inquiry, is that, in fact, recently the Iraqi parliament, I think, rendered a scathing report about Prime Minister Maliki's leadership or lack of leadership, effectively sort of suggesting that whatever he said couldn't be trusted. Is that, your estimate of his role of leading up to this crisis, in fact, over many years?
Sure. What we saw from the former prime minister was increasingly sectarian behavior and a number of bad decisions that led to the atrophy of his security forces. So,
In fact, according to this report, as I've seen in the media, that they attribute most of the blame for the disintegration of the Iraqi security forces at Maliki's doorstep, and no one else. Is that at least accurate for the feeling in Iraq?
I'd say it's primarily his responsibility and those who he appointed in key leader positions enable that as well.
In terms of your campaign plan, the sense I have is that you have tried to exploit the area where we have the most interest against ISIL, and that's Iraq. While maintaining as much pressure as possible in Syria. Is that the general outline of the campaign plan so that we would expect, and frankly, I must agree, I don't think anyone's seen the progress they'd like to see, but the first progress would essentially come in Iraq and then would lead to a better position against ISIL and Syria. Is that accurate?
It is, sir. In Iraq, there is a government for us to work with initially. There were some forces for us to begin to work with. And of course, we had access to things that could enable us to get the work done. And our shaping operations in Syria enabled our work in Iraq, and are still enabling it. And as we get increasing resources, we're able to increase the tempo in Syria. I think we'll have greater effects going forward.
And just finally, any general comments, because one of the recent developments is the fact that Turkey now is allowing operations out of Incirlik. They also seem to be much more cooperative in an operational sense. What do you expect in the next, say, 6 months that will translate to on the ground?
I think it'll translate to a lot more pressure on key areas in Syria, sir, like the city of Raqqa, which has long been an ISIL stronghold. And so because of that access, we'll have the ability to increase the pace and focus on key places in Syria. So that'll certainly shape things in Iraq.
Thank you very much, Madam Secretary and General.
Senator Fisher.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. General Austin, when Senator Carter was here before this committee in July, he testified that there were only about 60 Syrian fighters that had been trained in our train and equip program and reinserted. We've heard reports about the attacks on those individuals when they were reinserted back into Syria. Can you tell us what the total number of trained fighters remains?
It's a small number, and the ones that are in the fight is we're talking four or five.
A New York Times report on September 6 indicated that among the lessons learned from that experience was that these fighters should be returned to Syria in larger numbers than the 60, obviously larger than the four or five that are there. Do you agree with that?
I agree with that, Senator. Whenever that's possible, it is in our best interest to make sure that we have an element that can protect itself and also can go in and combine efforts with other elements that are on the ground. So.
How do you plan to achieve that? How are you going to increase the number of fighters when we're looking at the really tough security screening processes that are in place now? How are we going to achieve that? And how long will that take? And you mentioned earlier about increasing resources. I took that to mean increasing the number of fighters that you would place in Syria and the effect they would have. So what's the time period we're looking at here, and how are you going to do it? Because I don't think it's been at all successful yet.
I certainly agree with you that this the new Syrian force program has gotten off to a slow start. But I think it's important to remember that this element is designed to be a complement to all the other things that we're doing. So we're going to use, and we are using, every tool that we have available to us in our inventory. Our strategy is, or our approach is, to utilize indigenous forces to complement our work from the air on the ground.
If I can interrupt you on that point, I'd like to get back to your answer. When you say to complement the work on the ground with airstrikes, did I just hear you say that?
They have to work in tandem.
If they're going to work in tandem, there's a new article out today. Are we going to change strategy? Because I think it's in Foreign Policy Today that. It says the United States is drawing up a new plan that's going to send these trained fighters into Syria that are going to help direct airstrikes. Is that report correct?
I would just say that, ma'am, we'll continue to look at the best ways to the best means to employ these forces as we go forward, and we'll capitalize on lessons learned. And again. It is really about the full complement of indigenous forces that we have available to work with. As we mentioned earlier, the YPG, or the Syrian Kurds and some Arabs and Turkmen, have done tremendous work in northeast Syria. And they have pushed ISIL back from the border. They're currently somewhere around 40 kilometers or so north of ISIL's capital city of Raqqa. And they'll continue to pressure ISIL. So the new Syrian force is additive to that effort.
So with the fighters that we're training and equipping, is it still the goal to have about 12,000 of them there? Is that still the goal? What's the expectation then for them?
Well, we certainly won't, at the pace we're going, we won't reach the goal that we had initially established for ourselves. The overall goal is to make sure that we have enough mass to be able to get work done on the ground. And whether it's YPG elements or other elements that are able to help us, we can still achieve and are achieving the same effects. It's not aspirational. We're actually doing this today. And I think that's lost on a lot of people.
And is the strategy changing for the work on the ground that you're asking for these fighters?
We continue to look at the best means to employ them, and we will do what you would expect us to do, and make adjustments as opportunities present themselves.
Okay, thank you, sir.
General, just to follow up, there's a foreign policy says anxious to avoid another damaging setback for the training effort. The White House and the Pentagon are looking at attaching small numbers of fighters to larger established forces in northern Syria to ensure the rebels are better protected on the battlefield by more numerous experienced troops. Can you confirm or deny that that option is being looked at?
Senator.
Okay.
Senator, we are reviewing the way forward.
I'm asking if that option is being considered.
We are looking at a range of options, and one of the options
I'm not asking you to come before this committee and obfuscate. I'm asking you a direct question. Is the Pentagon looking at that option? Yes or no?
We are looking at that option as well as others.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Senator Nelson.
General, it's my understanding that General Dempsey recently said that if the U.S. really seized control of the campaign against ISIS, we could speed up ISIS defeat, but that it would come at a great cost to our service members, and that another group with another name and ideology would just be back in a couple of years. Isn't that what you understand General Dempsey to have said, and that you have reaffirmed that here today?
Yes, sir, it is. I think it's important that the people in the country and in the region take ownership and work to put in place lasting solutions. And if we don't do that, we will be back in another 2 or 3 years.
And because of that campaign against ISIS, it must be won by our coalition partners and the Iraqis, not just us.
That's correct, sir.
Would you care to read that statement again for clarity in your response to the chairman's question that General Dempsey had said in its full context?
Yes, sir. So what the chairman said was ISIL's future is increasingly dim as more nations join the anti-ISIL effort. He further stated that although the fight right now is tactically stalemated with no dramatic gains on either side, Iraq will move at the speed of its governance and not at the speed of its military capability.
Mr. Chairman, I have the transcript here in front of the committee. I would like to reinsert this transmit of General Dempsey with your permission.
Absolutely, and along with that, we will include the assessments by General Keane, General Petraeus, the architect of the surge, and all others who observed this debacle.
Of course. General, give us your assessment that Russia is building up the military base and sending soldiers and weapons into Syria to prop up Assad, under, I might say, the guise of fighting ISIS.
Sir, we are witnessing a buildup of forces in Syria by Russia. As you know, they have been there all along, but they are increasing their footprint. What they've stated is that they want to focus on helping to counter ISIL, as I understand it. That's left to be seen, and as you know, Russia is not very transparent, and so we really don't know what their true intentions are. The introduction of potential introduction of additional capability and operations, utilizing that capability, could increase the friction in that battle space significantly.
General, the Senate defense authorization bill calls for a 30% reduction in headquarters staff across the Department of Defense, starting with a 7.5% cut in fiscal year 2016. What impact will that cut have on your ability to conduct operations? And what is CENTCOM, if you want to submit for the record, planning to do to make that cut?
So if you take a look at what's going on in our region currently, you know, from Pakistan, Afghanistan, to Yemen, to Iraq and Syria, and to increase tensions in other places throughout the region, it's clear that we have a very active region. And so in order to manage the things that we need to manage and work with our partner nations in the region, we need an appropriate staff to be able to do that. I fully understand and appreciate, you know, the pressure that the department is under in terms of, you know, the reduction of the top line on the budget, and so we have to do what we can do and need to do to tighten our belts. I appreciate that, but it makes it increasingly difficult to get things done.
Thank you, General.
Senator Aya.
I want to thank the chairman. I want to thank both of you for being here today and for your service. I wanted to follow up and ask about, General, I believe you testified about the effectiveness of the Syrian Kurds right now in Syria in pushing back ISIL. And are we providing support and weapons to the Syrian Kurds? And what assistance are we giving them, given that, as I heard your testimony when Senator Fisher asked me, we only have, as I understand it, 4 or 5 of U.S.-trained Syrian fighters in this fight. So what are we doing to support the Syrian Kurds if they are effectively pushing back ISIL on the ground?
We are providing them a tremendous amount of air support, which is what they wanted most. As you'll recall, ma'am, this is the element, well, a portion of this element were the folks that hung on at Kobani valiantly. And it was doubtful at that point as to whether or not they would be able to survive in that environment and continue to do things. Well, they continued on, and they increased their size and activity, and they've made a significant difference in the northeast part of the country. And so what they've asked from us over time is sustained air power, sustained strikes. And they have benefited from those strikes. And because of their aggressiveness, they've made a tremendous difference in the northeast.
So just to be clear, they haven't asked for arms. And how is Turkey acting on the ground here in terms of obviously, first of all, I want to know, what have the Syrian Kurds asked for that we haven't given them? I understand the air support, but also, how do you view Turkey's role in all of this? Because as I see it right now, this 4 or 5 U.S.-trained fighters, let's not kid ourselves, that's a joke. And so if they're the only force on the ground doing something right now, what more can we do to help them?
Up to this point, they have not asked us for arms, but it doesn't mean that they won't, ma'am. I think, and of course, you know, as we go forward, there are things that we can do to continue to help as they try to get supplies into northern Syria, work with the Kurds in northern Iraq to help make sure that we have lines of communication that facilitate that, and we're doing that. They will also need to partner with Syrian Arabs in the area, and they're doing that. And we are working with Syrian Arabs, developing relationships as well. And so I think it's a combination of all of these forces that are going to make a difference going forward. And again, we expect our footprint with the new Syrian forces to grow over time.
So can you help me on Turkey, what role Turkey is playing or not playing here that we would like to see Turkey play?
As you know, Senator, Turkey has just recently come on board and given us access to their bases, which is a tremendous capability. It shortens the legs of our fighter pilots will have to fly. It allows us to be more responsive. They also are flying strikes in our formations and focused on elements, ISIL elements in Syria thus far. And so they are adding value. And what we've asked them to do as well is to continue to tighten up or abate the flow of foreign fighters and lethal accelerants coming across the border.
So I want to ask before we leave, what role is Iran playing right now in Syria? How much support are they providing for the Assad regime? How do we evaluate their significance in fueling this conflict? And also their support for Hezbollah, what role is Hezbollah playing in terms of supporting the Assad regime?
Well, we know that Iran has been instrumental in providing support to Syria throughout, and we see increasingly that they would like to provide, they want to provide more support. What that will mean in the future, I don't know, but they are active in Syria.
So perhaps if they had more cash and money, they might support. They would like to provide more support to the Assad regime.
That would be my assumption would be that would be the case.
Mm-hmm. I wanted to also ask, with as our issues with these trained fighters, are we going to provide, if they're under attack? I guess we got four or five of them, but if for some reason we were able to get more of them trained, what are we going to do to support them or protect them?
We will protect provide air support and ISR to overwatch and air support to protect them. And with the first class that we put in, we have done that already. So we are committed to doing that going forward.
Thank you,
Senator McCaskill.
I'm worried, like the rest of my colleagues, and there have been a number of questions on this already about the train and equip mission. And, you know, there's good news and there's bad news about America's military. The good news is if you give them a job, they figure out a way to get it done. The bad news is sometimes you give them a job and they are not willing to say when it's not going to work. At what point in time, General Austin, do you envision us admitting that while all good intentions and on paper, all of the work was done, but the job of finding willing fighters that can be screened appropriately when you have the vast majority who feel victimized by the current situation in Syria are running for the exits? At what point in time, and what is the discussion ongoing about the $600 million you're requesting for next year? That seems very unrealistic to me in terms of a request. If at this juncture we've successfully completed 5 to 6, and I believe you said the last information I had, Ms. Wormuth, was 100. You said more than 100. What is the number?
Senator McCaskill, it's between 100 and 120.
Okay.
Basically.
So we're counting on our fingers and toes at this point when we had envisioned 5,400 by the end of the year. And I'm just worried that this is one of those instances where the good news about our military is dominating. We can do this, we can do this, and the practical realities of this strategy aren't being fully embraced.
Thank you, Senator. You know, I absolutely agree with you. We have the finest troops in the world, and they will figure out a way to get the job done one way or the other. And again, what our special operations forces have done in northern Syria is they didn't wait for the new Syrian force program or train and equip program to fully develop. At the very outset, they began to engage elements like the YPG and enable those elements, and they are making a difference on the battlefield. And there are tens of thousands of the YPG out there. They're right now fighting ISIL. So because the Syria Train and Equip program is slower getting started than we'd like for it to be, it doesn't mean that we're not creating effects on the battlefield.
I just want to make sure, General Austin, I mean, I know the chairman feels strongly about the success of the surge, and there was a lot of incredible American heroes that were part of that surge. But the other part of the surge we don't talk about as frequently is that we paid a lot of people. We paid a lot of people to help us during the surge. Is this money that we're setting aside for train and equip, would it be better off in direct compensation to some of that YPG force?
Senator McCaskill, can I try to address this a little bit? As General Austin said, we are reviewing the program and we're looking at a range of options. Our train and equip program is part of a broader effort that we're prosecuting with the YPG, with the Syrian Arab Coalition, and so on. And we're looking at how to have our train and equip program effectively enable those other efforts. And I think as we go forward and look at what our options are, we'll absolutely want to look at the resources we've requested for the next year and how that fits in. But the forces that we are training, while right now are small in number and clearly are not going to reach the numbers that we had planned for, are nevertheless getting terrific training and very good equipment, and as such will be able to really be force multipliers of those other groups on the ground that have been very effective, like the Syrian Arab Coalition,
for example. If we end up at the end of the year with us bragging about the difference between 100 and 120, it's time for a new plan.
And I certainly do not mean to be bragging. The program is much smaller than we hoped.
Yeah.
We're not bragging.
I don't have much time left, but I want to just, I know, understand from your testimony, General Austin, you can't comment about the IG investigation into this accusation that people are putting pressure on intelligence analysts to change the tenor of their reports. It's a serious allegation that strikes at the core of our government in terms of our ability to oversee and make decisions around the use of our military. I want to say at the end of this investigation, when you can discuss it, I want to just put on the record that I, for one, I'm going to be watching very carefully about any potential retaliation against any of the men or women that may have come forward with allegations. It is incredibly important that whistleblowers be protected in this space. And depending on what the investigation finds, I understand that maybe there are other factors I'm not aware of. But I just wanted to put on the record that I will be paying very close attention to how these whistleblowers are treated in the aftermath of this investigation.
I absolutely share your concern, Senator, and you have my I will assure you that we will do everything within our power to ensure that the whistleblowers remain protected and there is no retaliation. This is absolutely important. And again, you know, we need oversight by organizations like the IG, and so we welcome that. And we're going to cooperate fully, and we'll make sure that we abide by the spirit of this investigation.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, Chairman McCain, and I think the grim nature of your remarks are justified. Ms. Wormuth, how long has it been since we've had this train and equip program in effect?
Senator, we started the actual training earlier this spring. We started the program in December when we got authority from Congress.
Right.
We spent time putting together.
So you have to say we started in December. That's when it was authorized and funding is provided.
Sir.
And we have to acknowledge this is a total failure. It's just a failure. And I wish it weren't so, but that's the fact. And so it is time to, way past time, to react to that failure. I just would say the whole idea that we've got to wait for the locals to take ownership and to take the lead and do this kind of activity without any leadership support sufficient from the United States or our allies is also a failure. They're not able to organize well. Mosul has fallen. There's a divisions within Iraq that make it very difficult. So I just wish it weren't so, but I'm afraid that's the reality we are dealing with. We now have, I believe the UN says, 4 million refugees, 7 million displaced persons. It's obvious to me that this is a humanitarian catastrophe. We need to deal with it in an honest way, and the most effective and honest way is to keep
people as close to home as possible. If they can't stay in their homes because of violence and war, then they ought to be kept as close to home as possible. I talked to a senior European official recently, and he told me that this refugee crisis is the greatest threat to Europe since World War II. And I don't see any plan to make it any better. General Austin, we've got to consider creating safe zones within Syria. I understand there are some places in Syria now that refugees can stay. And we're going to have to keep, we can't have millions and millions of people walking into Europe. This goes without, it's hardly worth discussing. So I am really worried about this and wish that we could, we'd already done much better. By being so slow to act initially, this is what has resulted. And now the situation is far more grim than it should be, in my opinion. General Austin, I do tend to agree with you that a defeat of ISIL is not the end of the problems in the Middle East. We've got a spasm of extremism that witnesses have told us may be going on for 50 years. Would you agree with that?
I absolutely agree, Senator.
One victory here doesn't mean it's a total victory. There'll be another problem somewhere else as long as this ideology is out there.
Yes, sir.
And I just believe, Ms. Wormuth, that we need a strategy, a understood strategy, bipartisan, in this Congress with our allies around the world to confront this long-term, multi-decade threat to the Western democratic order and to try to help protect people in the Middle East from this disaster. So I want to ask you, do we have a strategy of that kind that our allies in the United States and Congress and Republicans and Democrats understand and agree on?
Senator, I think we have a strategy to defeat ISIL ultimately in the Middle East, where it's largely in the Middle East, but it's obviously spreading to other areas. There are other dynamics in the Middle East, obviously, that are a part of this. There's the broader Sunni Shia sectarian conflict that has gone on for decades. There are the fact that many of the governments in that region are not very representative and have internal policies that don't give much freedoms to their people. So they're part of that's part of what's creating the problem in the Middle East
well.
And a big part of our relationships with these countries is talking to them about the importance of more democratic approaches.
Well said in one sense. However, does that mean that we don't support the King of Jordan?
Jordan is...
No, just asking rhetorically, okay?
Mm-hmm.
No, we've got to have a more realistic policy than that. I was just reading Henry Kissinger's book on order, and he just last night hit the part about George Kennan and the containment strategy that maintained Western unity, free world against the communist totalitarians. And it went on for 50 years almost. Ended up ultimately was successful. This is the way it was expressed. Soviet expansionism, according to Kennan, was real and inherent. The conflict was inherent in the two ideologies. It's incompatible, totalitarian communism and constitutional democracy. And he said, but it could be, quote, contained by an adroit and vigilant application of counterforce at a series of constantly shifting geographical and political points, close quote. And I don't sense that we have any such strategy, and I'm sorry we don't. And I think also that radical Islam, Sharia law, is part essential component, is incompatible with constitutional democracy. We need to work better. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Thank you both for being here. Since Senator Sessions' comment about communism and containment is a good segue into my first question, which is for Ms. Wormuth, why do you believe that 4 years into this conflict that Russia is deploying materiel and increased shipments to the Assad regime and really setting up shop in Syria in a way that they haven't over the last 4 years?
Well, Russia has certainly been a supporter of the Assad regime for some time, and I think Putin has spoken more publicly about the role Russia has played to date. I think part of what may be happening, part of Putin's calculus may be that Assad's regime has been under greater threat in the last several months as ISIL has advanced in places like Palmyra, and Tadmor. So Putin may be nervous about the stability of the Assad regime and may be trying to shore it up.
Well, given that, how do we assess the possibility that the Assad regime might fall?
I think at this point, the assessments I've read are that the regime actually still has considerable strength in terms of its military forces. It's still the most powerful military force on the ground. And the support it receives from Iran and Russia remains significant. So there have certainly been battlefield losses that are concerning, but and we are looking at, obviously, how to deal with, we are planning and thinking about the potential for a significant retrenchment. But I think the assessment right now is that the regime is not in imminent danger of falling.
So if Russia deploys air defense systems in Syria, maybe this is a question for you, General Austin, are we concerned that they'll threaten our coalition aircraft?
That if they're trying to operate in the same space, Senator, that possibility is clearly there.
And how are we thinking about responding to that?
Well,
for either of you.
I think we're still in the early stages of what exactly Russia is doing. But one, at the diplomatic level, we're making very clear that deployments that are going to shore up the regime, draw out the conflict, are counterproductive and destabilizing. And that if this is really about Russia trying to join the fight against ISIL, then we would expect the kinds of military capabilities they deploy to be consistent with that.
So how are we making that clear to Russia?
Well, there are a number of channels, but in particular, Secretary Kerry speaks to his counterpart very regularly and has been making that point very clear. And then I would say on the military side, and I'm sure General Austin can elaborate on this, if in fact it gets to a point where we see Russian aircraft operating in that area, we would, I would imagine, need to set up some sort of deconfliction mechanism so that we can continue our counter-ISIL campaign there.
General Austin?
And we know how to do that, Senator. And you know, my utmost concern is protection of our troops. And we're going to make sure that we have the ability to protect ourselves at all time. And you know, there are, on occasion, Syrian aircraft that are flying in spaces that are not too distant from where we're operating. But we're able to make sure that number one, we maintain vigilance, and number two, we keep the the battle space. We work in a battle space in such a way that we avoid conflict, avoid encounter, if at all possible.
So I appreciate that that has been our policy to date, given the total failure of our ability to influence the outcome of the Syrian civil war. Are we assessing whether we should take a different response with respect to Assad? And engaging with the Syrian troops?
I think we continue to look, we continue to believe that what would be the best solution is to get a political transition and get Assad out of the government while retaining the governance structures so that you don't have a situation of chaos on the ground. Russia, with its relationship with the regime, could potentially contribute to helping find that solution. That would be a valuable contribution from Russia.
Well, it would be, but there's no incentive at this point for Russia to do that.
I think
what's the incentive?
I think their incentive would be to have, they want more than anything a more stable Syria, and they are quite fearful of ISIL as well. I mean, they have many Chechens in Russia. They are just as concerned about foreign fighter flows from ISIL as we are. So I think Russia does have an interest in having a more stable Syria, and a constructive way for them to engage would be to work with us and other countries who would like to see a transition there to try to come up with a diplomatic way to make that transition happen.
Well, I certainly think that would be a positive outcome, but it's not clear to me that we've seen any action in the last 4.5 years to suggest that Russia is going to play a more positive role. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. General Austin, thank you for your service. In both Syria and in Iraq, we have displaced individuals that clearly are part of the discussion on the worldwide stage, individuals moving into Europe. I'm curious, in terms of the numbers right now, and this would be a question for either of you, but do we have an update on the total number of individuals who are displaced between Syria and Iraq that you could share with us this morning?
I believe, Senator, that it's around 4 million. It's a very large number. I mean, there are more than a million.
No, that would be from Syria.
I thought it was from Syria and Iraq. But for example, there's more than a million refugees in Turkey right now. There are many hundreds of thousands, if not a million, refugees in Jordan. So the neighboring countries are already hosting very large numbers of refugees, Lebanon, Jordan, and Turkey.
Before we're done, could you maybe just check and see if the numbers that you're providing
are
up to date? What I'm curious about are the number of individuals displaced both in Syria and the number of individuals who are displaced in Iraq, but still perhaps in Iraq.
We can get you that breakdown.
Thank you. I would appreciate that. General, the reason for my question is that the it would appear that as this number is a significant number, most certainly they are part of any concern with regard to military operations, regardless of where you're at, and our desire not to do more harm than good in what we provide. And yet at the same time, one of our expectations is that we're doing ongoing air operations throughout the area. We don't want to get into areas where we're going to actually cause more damage, and yet right now, you're challenged because you really don't have the forward air observers that would make it more efficient than what you've got today. Can you share with us a little bit about what you're doing to try to improve that situation and how you would like to see that handled?
Sir, we routinely use all of our intelligence, surveillance, and reconnaissance assets, UAVs, and manned aircraft, to make sure that we understand what's going on the ground before we employ weapons, and we are diligent in our efforts there, not overly cautious to the point where we're not able to take advantage of opportunities to engage the enemy, but we were very, very mindful of the possibility of increase committing civilian casualties there.
But at this time, sir, it's fair to say that we're not using any of our own forward air observers yet at all. We don't have any forward air observers on the ground at all.
That's correct, sir. Our JTACs are operating in the command centers. Now, what that does is it allows the JTACs to have visibility over, you know, what's going on in the target area, but it also enables him to gain visibility of where the friendly troops are. And this is one of the biggest challenges that we encounter throughout this battle space. In a lot of cases, the folks we're trying to help don't have a good handle on where their people are. And that slows down our ability to engage.
Currently, when you are training individuals in Iraq and those who want to fight back in Syria, we understand, and I think I don't think there's anybody out here that's disagreeing with the fact that we're not on schedule for getting the number that we want to have trained. Is that a fair assessment yet? In terms of the number of individuals that we want to have trained that are both Iraqi nationals and Syrian nationals?
I'm struggling with my sign there. But you're right, sir. We would like to see a lot more forces available to be trained, and we're encouraging the government of Iraq to recruit those forces, bring them on board so we can get them into training centers. And what we've discovered, not discovered, but what we knew this going in, is that those forces that have been trained by us are doing pretty well on the battlefield.
Fair to say, though, General, that one of the problems we've got, particularly with Syrian fighters, is that in our ability to actually discern which ones we can use and which ones we're not using based upon our review of their background and what they intend to do, if they want to go in and fight Assad, basically it's eliminating them from being part of our team. Fair to say at this point?
That's correct, sir. We're focused on countering ISIL.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Both of you have testified that our very strict vetting process has resulted in far fewer fighters for us to train. Does this mean that we're turning away thousands of potential fighters?
Senator, I would say two things. One, because the authority we have focuses our program on fighting ISIL, there are a number of individuals who might like to receive training from the United States or equipment, for that matter, focus of our program. And then the other way the standards affect the recruiting pool is obviously we want to make sure that we have confidence in the people we bring into our program and that we can give them equipment and trust them to use that appropriately, trust them to fight on the battlefield in a way that's consistent with the laws of armed conflict. And in many cases, people who might be interested in volunteering don't meet those standards or are younger than, are under the age of 18, for example, or who are otherwise not medically qualified.
Assessments that you're doing is to review whether or not we're being unrealistic and regarding the kinds of factors that we want you to take into consideration before you will train a particular individual. Is that one of the areas that you are looking to, which may require congressional action?
We certainly are looking at our recruiting and screening process all of the time. Even before, frankly, the first class was reinserted, we were looking at how to speed up our recruiting process and speed up the screening process. We are looking at the kinds of criteria that we have in place, but I think our view is that right now our criteria are very consistent with the requirements that Congress gave us, and if we were to loosen them, for example, I think we would absolutely have to come back to you all and ask for a...
Well, and that is my question, whether or not you're seriously considering asking us to reevaluate the criteria that Congress established. Now, I know we're talking today a lot about what's going on the ground, but of concern is also, and you mentioned this in your testimony, that you're looking for more effective ways to counter ISIL's very effective messaging campaign. There are concerns about ISIL's ability to motivate lone wolves who will take action without ever having direct contact with ISIL. And so taking actions in our country as well as elsewhere. So what are some of the effective ways that you are countering ISIL's messaging strategy?
I think we are taking some steps that are effective, but we need to do more. Part of what we have been working, for example, closely with a number of countries in the coalition to identify communicators inside of those communities who have credibility with Muslim populations and who will be able to lay out a compelling reasons why ISIL's theology is completely bankrupt. So we've been working with governments to counter violent extremism. We have been working to get our messages out about military successes that we have more effectively, but a lot of it is working with the private sector and the civil society to try to get the right kinds of messengers to speak to these kinds of groups. It's a very challenging part of our effort, and I think we need to do more there.
I completely agree with that, because I do think that the lone wolf phenomenon and the problem is one that we really don't have a very good handle on. General, I think you mentioned that you thought that there were signs that Iran would like to be more active in supporting Syria, and possibly that because of the agreement and they're getting their hands on more money as the sanctions get lifted. You said you saw some signs that Iran would like to do more. So what are these signs that you're referring to? because we know that Iran is already supporting Syria. So, you know, are you expecting that they're going to put billions more into their support of Assad?
They are already supporting Syria. So
yes.
You're exactly right. As things become more dynamic in Syria and the regime is increasingly challenged, it's my assessment that that Iran will want to continue to try to shore them up in a greater way.
And it's not as though our country is going to just stand by idly while Iran proceeds with that kind of a program, correct? We're not going to just sit there.
No, certainly not. I mean, we absolutely are very focused on countering Iran's malign activities in Syria as well as the broader region. We have sanctions of our own that are in place to try to block arms, for example, going to countries. We have interdicted or worked with folks in the coalition to interdict weapons going from Iran to the Houthis, for example, and we would continue to try to use those kinds of tools to limit Iran's ability to support the Syrians.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, for calling this important hearing, and thank you, Secretary Wormuth and General Austin, for taking the time today to answer our questions. It's deeply appreciated. It's been 1 year since President Obama announced to the world that the United States would undertake a strategy to degrade and defeat ISIS in order to return some semblance of stability to Iraq and create an environment that could lead to a negotiated end to the civil war in Syria. It was my belief that President Obama's overall goal and the strategy he outlined to achieve that goal may have been beset from the outset by some flawed assumptions, some contradictions, and perhaps an excessive reliance on political forecasting in a region of the world that is anything but easy to predict. Now, this, compounded by a string of recent events, is why I think it may be time for us to reassess the way the United States views this conflict and chooses to respond to it. And I think we need to start by making clear-eyed threat assessments and prioritizing U.S. national security interests. General Austin, what's your assessment of the most significant threats that the conflict in Syria and in Iraq pose to the security of U.S. citizens and our freedoms? And in other words, at the end of the day, what needs to be accomplished for the U.S. government to fulfill, to perform its constitutional duty to protect the people of the United States and our interests?
This is a, thank you, Senator. This is a transnational threat, and if left unchecked, it will continue to expand and to try to take up or occupy territory and govern. In doing so, it will try to erase international boundaries. It will try to do a number of things that will cause tremendous pain and suffering throughout the region. It will also export terror. In my belief, it will export terror to other parts of the world, and particularly to places like our homeland. We see the beginnings of this in this lone wolf activity that we talk about. We also see, or we are concerned about, individuals who go into Iraq and Syria and fight as a part of this effort and return, potentially return back to our homeland and bring those skills back with them. So this is a threat to us, and I think the threat will continue to increase.
Now, the administration's strategy is to create an environment in Syria that will be likely to lead to a negotiated settlement of the civil war and result in the removal of Bashar al-Assad from power in Damascus. In your professional military opinion, General Austin, and given your knowledge of the region, what level of pressure would need to be leveraged against Mr. Assad and his supporters in order for them to capitulate, especially as many Alawites and other minority groups view some opposition groups as a threat to their survival, and how much investment would be needed from the coalition countries in order to provide security and stability in a hypothetical post-Assad Syria?
I think that Assad would only be willing, as you have stated, Senator, to come to the table to negotiate a settlement if he feels like he is threatened. And as things continue to develop in the country, we see a number of elements, Al Nusra Front, others that are fighting the regime, ISIL, you know, their efforts come together and place increasing pressure on Assad. He is losing. He still has significant capability, but he's losing capability every day. Now, the wild card is when countries like Iran or potentially Russia could possibly move in and shore him up, it could extend things for a bit of time. Now, in a post-Assad environment, we have to consider that there are a number of elements there that will continue to be there and will continue to fight. Al-Nusra is one of those elements. If there are remnants of ISIL there, they'll continue to fight. So it will require some sort of stability force to go in and make sure that that whatever the transition government looks like, it has the ability to do its job. So.
Thank you, General Austin. I see my time's expired. Thank you, Chairman.
Thank you. On behalf of Chairman McCain, let me recognize Senator McCain.
Great. Thank you, Senator Reid, and thanks to our witnesses. I'm going to start with a compliment, but then I'm going to revert to form of everybody else on the committee and express some major concerns. The compliment was I was in Erbil, Baghdad, Kuwait, Jordan, and Turkey in late June and early July, and I was in President Barzani's office in Erbil, and he said if President Obama had not started the bombing campaign on Mount Sinjar on August 8th, we would not be here today. And he meant we, the Kurdish people in the Kurdistan. He wanted us to extend our thanks back to the administration and Congress. And I also saw a joint operations command at the airport in Erbil with a very close coordination between U.S. forces and the Kurdish Peshmerga that was very impressive. However, everywhere else I traveled to Baghdad and to the other parts of the region, it seems like there's major problems. The effort to retake Ramadi that was begun in mid-July is apparently not going that well. And then Syria, absent some successes in the Kurdish area near Kobani, has been very, very disastrous. I was not an original supporter when Senator McCain raised the idea of a no-fly humanitarian zone in the fall of 2013. I listened to General Dempsey tell us why that was not a good idea, and I generally agreed with him. But by the time Senator King and I went to Lebanon in February of 2014 and saw a million refugees already into Lebanon, I became converted. When Senator McCain pushed the idea of a humanitarian zone first, there was only about 750,000 Syrian refugees in Turkey. There's now 1.8 million. It will be 2 million soon. There's 4 million. The number is 4 million Syrians have fled outside the country, and there's 7.8 million internally displaced Syrians in the country, and they could easily leave the country as well. A humanitarian zone in northern Syria would be very difficult to do, but I think the benefit of that compared with 4 million and then climbing to it could be 6, it could be 7, it could be 8 million refugees, some of whom could be very, very dangerous leaving the country. I think we would have been wise to do it when Senator McCain suggested it, and I think we would still be wise to do it. And from having met with a number of Syrian refugees in Gaziantep, Turkey, an awful lot of those who fled the country would go back if they felt that there was a place where basic needs would be met and they would be safe. So I would encourage that. That's not your decision to make. I would encourage that the administration. Let me talk about the General Austin, you said a second ago in response, I think, to Senator McCain's question that you thought the war against ISIL would go on for years. Is that correct?
Yes, sir, it is.
Just editorial comment, I don't think go on for years and the chances of success of ISIL are dimmed. I don't think those are compatible statements. That was a quote from Chairman Dempsey that ISIL's chances of success are dimming. The war going to go on for years. I don't think those are really compatible statements. It seems like the ISIL threat is expanding geographically. We're talking heavily about Iraq and Syria here, but There is ISIL presence in Libya that we're paying attention to. There is ISIL presence in Afghanistan, largely disaffected Taliban who are moving over and claiming allegiance to ISIL. Boko Haram has pledged allegiance to ISIL, not yet threatening the United States, as far as I know. There may be some ISIL presence in Yemen. Is that correct?
That is correct, sir. There is.
So the potential battlefield against ISIL is expanding. And we're actually maybe engaging in some new activity. My understanding, General Austin, you indicated we have undertaken airstrikes to support trained Syrians in Syria when they have been threatened by al-Nusra, correct?
That's correct, sir.
And we are also prepared, as of a change in policy from early August, to undertake airstrikes to protect those Syrian fighters if they fall under threat and attack by the Assad regime?
That's correct, sir.
Now, I tactically completely agree with that, but I got to ask, what is the legal predicate for the United States undertaking military action against forces of the Assad regime?
Senator, our determination is that, as you know very well, we can defend against ISIL and al-Nusra under the 2001 AUMF, and if our forces are attacked by the regime in a particular circumstances, the President could exercise his Article II rights under the Constitution.
If our forces, if the U.S. is attacked, Article II comes into play.
I meant our forces, meaning the T&E forces that we've trained.
I will just say, I have not seen an interpretation of Article II ever that would allow the United States to undertake action under Article II to protect others' fighters. You can take action under Article II to protect the U.S., President doesn't need to ask anybody's permission for that, but to undertake action to protect others' fighters, I've never seen an interpretation of Article II that would do this. Last thing I'll say, Mr. Chair, and set aside, there's a lot more criticisms I would get into here and that a lot of us have, but I worry that Congress is criticizing you as if we were editorial writers. We got a lot of opinions. We're acting like fans in the stands. We still have not authorized this war. We still have not authorized this war. I believe it is being carried out in violation of basic legal principles because Congress has not done what Congress is supposed to do. We can be fans in the stands and throw all the criticisms we want, but we are in the 14th month of an undeclared war that is based upon a legal justification that is specious, in my view. But Congress has allowed it to happen, completely giving up their Article I responsibilities. And now that we've been told that the war is going to go on for years, my question is just to my colleagues, how long are we going to allow a president to wage an executive war without a congressional authorization? I think we're afraid to touch this, so we can criticize this all we want. And we'll have many more hearings like this over the course of a number of years, and I'm sure we'll have critical things to say. But if we're not willing to do our constitutional duty, I mean, why are we here? We're not fans. We're supposed to be the owners of this team. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Senator Kane. On behalf of the chairman, I recognize Senator Cotton.
If that's the question, I will say the answer is wars are not won with paper resolutions. They are won with iron resolution, and that is clearly lacking in our strategy right now against the Islamic State. General Austin, Ms. Wormuth, thank you for coming. General Austin, in particular, for all the thousands of troopers you represent for your service and their service. I want to speak briefly about the reports that there may have been some efforts to cook the books about our performance in the campaign against the Islamic State. I know in your opening statement you acknowledged this, acknowledged the problem. There is ongoing investigations to include with the IG, but you have an ongoing challenge in your intelligence reporting and the way that affects your operations as well as the command climate. So putting aside the IG investigation, could you just tell us what steps you're taking to confront those challenges that you face on a daily basis?
I have recently and continue to emphasize, Senator, to all of my subordinates that my expectation is that I get candid and accurate intelligence assessments from my staff. I've also emphasized to my entire command, as I have in every command that I've had, that the welfare of my people is extremely important to me. And so, I care about my people. My expectation is that they have a climate that's conducive to providing for a good, healthy, sound work environment for them. So.
Thank you. I mean, I would have to say, too, as someone who regularly consumes intelligence community products on the Islamic State and our campaign against them as a member of this committee and a member of the Intelligence Committee, I was very surprised to hear allegations that books are being cooked, because those products are not painting a very pretty picture of how this campaign is going. General Austin, I want to move now to events in Syria, and in particular, Russia's military buildup. Published reports have said in the last couple of weeks, to include admissions of senior Russian officials, that Russia is sending aircraft there, air defense systems, armored personnel carriers, main battle tanks now, in addition to life support systems like modular housing that are clearly designed for a large and continued presence. How many airstrikes is the coalition conducting on a daily basis right now in Syria?
We're conducting overall about 24 or so airstrikes in Iraq and Syria, and about a third of those are in Syria. So,
what efforts, if any, do we have underway to deconflict this battle space now that we have hundreds, perhaps thousands of Russians running around with air defense systems and battle tanks and personnel carriers?
Well, we continue to, from a military perspective, we continue to look at what the possibilities for encounters are, Senator, and we have we make sure that we have measures in place to ensure that that we don't have an inadvertent encounter with either Russia, a Russian aircraft, or a Syrian aircraft.
Do our pilots have to have 100% positive identification that there is no Russian on a target before they can strike that target?
Well, we've not, the Russians, to my knowledge, have not started operations as of this point, so we've not had to encounter that yet. But clearly, these are things that, from a tactical perspective, that we will continue to work and think through. So.
Assad's other main supporter inside of Syria is Iran, and specifically the Revolutionary Guard Corps and the Quds Force, which has been present in Syria for years. Do our pilots have to have 100% positive identification that there is no Iranian forces on a target before they strike that target?
Our pilots have to have 100%, they have to have certainty, Senator, that there are ISIL targets there that will be engaged. And since, as you know, we can see what we're shooting at or what we're engaging, this is not an issue. So.
Mr. Wormuth, there's a report recently in the media that Russia offered in 2012 to help the West remove Assad from power, and that the United States declined that offer because we believed that Assad would fall of his own accord. Is that an accurate report?
I don't believe that's an accurate report. But that's obviously from several years ago, and I wasn't in this position at that time, so I don't believe it's accurate, but I don't believe it's accurate.
Do you believe that Iran and their proxies can be a partner in the fight against the Islamic State in any way in Iraq or Syria?
No, not really. I mean, we're not cooperating with Iran right now in Iraq, for example. We're deconflicting. They certainly have a role with some of the Shia militia on the ground, some of the popular mobilization forces. But we are not cooperating, and I don't see Iran as having a productive role in either Iraq or Syria.
Thank you. I would agree, given the fact that there are militias in Iraq and rely on U.S. Air power, and now they appear to be relying on Russian forces in Iran to back up their hapless efforts, that they aren't going to be a partner, and trying to rely on Iran to defeat the Islamic State is like trying to rely on gasoline to put out a fire.
Thank you, Senator Cotton. On behalf of the chairman, Senator King.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. General, I just want to touch for a few moments on the intelligence issue. I consider this extremely grave, a grave issue, because if we don't have reliable intelligence as policymakers, and if the president doesn't have reliable intelligence, we can't make good policy, and this keeps happening. I mean, this goes back to the Bay of Pigs, Vietnam, the Iraq War, and this allegation is, these allegations are extremely serious, and I hope you will. I understand we have an IG investigation, but as a commanding officer, I would hope that you would just be all over this. And I want to ask you a direct question. Have you ever ordered, suggested, or hinted to any of the intelligence command that they should sweeten the intelligence reports in order to portray a more positive view of the success of our efforts in Iraq or Syria?
Absolutely not, Senator King. Absolutely not.
Well, I just hope that you will just stay on this because, as you know better than any of us, if you don't have good intelligence, you're not only going into the battle blind, and if it's cooked intelligence, you're going into the battle with one hand tied behind your back. So I'm extremely concerned about this issue. This is a question for the record. You use the term progress in your statement a number of times, progress here and progress there. Not now, but for the record, I would like a very specific list of what you consider progress, where we are succeeding, because generally it doesn't look like that. It looks more like a stalemate, and I think, again, we should have this information, and I know some of it is in your testimony, but I'd like, if you could, just a one-pager on where you think progress has been made.
Be happy to provide that, sir. We'll get that to you right away.
Thank you. And I think from a broad question of policy, and this comes off of a lot of the other discussion we've had, Assad and ISIS are evil twins. ISIS largely came into existence in reaction to Assad. And in retrospect, and like Senator Kaine, I was one who was very reluctant about getting involved, but in retrospect, the longer we've left Assad there, it has created a situation, both a humanitarian crisis and a situation that has allowed al-Nusra and ISIL. ISIL didn't even exist when we first started having these hearings. And it's allowed them to it's given them an enemy and an opportunity to make hay with the population. So a strategy that ignores Assad and, for example, trains troops to go into Syria to only fight ISIL but not Assad, I just think I think we now need to recognize that that's not a logical strategy. And part of good strategic thinking is that you modify your strategy according to changed circumstances. And the circumstances are, and you mentioned he's losing his capabilities every day. I'm sorry, General, I've been hearing that at every hearing since 2013. Assad is about to go, he's about to collapse. And I know you didn't say that today, but we've got to find a strategy that allows us to move Assad aside in some way, working with the Russians if necessary, or the Iranians if necessary, because he's the irritant that's keeping this thing stirred up. And then finally, in terms of our troops, the fundamental problem, it seems to me, is we're not going to defeat ISIS with just air power. Everybody knows that. We're trying to rely on a weak force in Iraq and no force in Syria. How do we refine this strategy, General? And you know that in order to root them out of Mosul or Iraq or any place else, you're going to have troops on the ground. We don't want them to be Americans. How do we break through this? Clearly, the train and equip is just too little, too late. Your thoughts?
We're going to need a greater commitment from the partners that we're enabling, Senator. You know, again, if the Iraqis make the commitment to put more troops through the train and equip program, we'll get them trained and equipped, and we'll get them into the fight.
Are there signs that the Iraqis are willing to do that? Do they want Mosul back?
I think so. I certainly think so. They want to stabilize Anbar first and then take on Mosul. But yes, I believe that.
Ms. Wormuth, give me some thoughts on the overall strategy here.
Certainly, Senator. I was going to say, in terms of getting more Iraqis into the fight, they are, as I said, they're opening the aperture in terms of which units they're putting into our training sites. So that's going to help, I think, create additional troops.
I'd like specific numbers on that, by the way, for the record.
Certainly. And they are. We see them starting to now plan ahead in terms of which units are going into the training pipeline, which again I think indicates a greater sense of urgency on their part. And on the Syrian side of the ledger, I would say it is clearly harder to find partners on the ground on the Syrian side of the ledger. But one of the things that we didn't envision a year ago was the partnership, if you will, that we have of our air power with the Syrian Kurds and the Syrian Arab coalition that are operating with them. That group on its own won't be enough, but we are continuing to look for opportunities like that, even as we review our own train and equip
well,
program.
Well, I would join in Senator Kaine's remarks that I really think you need to rethink a strategy about a safe zone, a no-fly zone, some protection from Assad's barrel bombs. This is something, I hate it when the chairman's right, but he's been talking about this for 2 years. And in retrospect, I think he was right. We've allowed this to just, the atrocity to go on too long, and it's impacting us, it's impacting the rest of Europe, and I really think that there should be a rethinking of the non-intervention strategy, not in terms of troops, but in terms of air power, in order to level the playing field, bring pressure on Assad and the Russians so that we can get a negotiated agreement, because it doesn't seem to be in prospect now. Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. And again, upon behalf of the Chairman, Senator Tillis.
Thank you. Ms. Wormuth, you may have, in your opening statement, I apologize, I had to step out, I had to go to a Judiciary Committee meeting, but you made a comment in your opening statement that I want to focus a little bit of time on through a series of questions that hopefully I can get brief remarks. You said that ISIS is not 10 foot tall. The reason that I have a concern with that kind of statement is that it's reminiscent of characterizing them as a JV team. They are a very serious threat. Before I go forward, General Austin, I neglected to do what I always do when I see people in uniform. Thank you for your service. I know you guys are a part of the solution. But when we say that ISIS is not 10 feet tall, they are the richest threat group of this kind in human history. Through the seizure of assets for the Iraqi National Bank, I think they seized some $820 million. Last week, we just had a memorial for 9/11. It's estimated that the 9/11 attacks cost about $500,000. Through that one asset seizure, if my math is right, that equates to about 1,600 9/11s, having the resources to strike that kind of damage in our homeland, in the Middle East, in Europe, and other places. I think that we need to recognize them as one of the single greatest threats that we have today. Of course, we have Russia, North Korea, Iran, but they're at the front line for people that we have to take seriously. And we have to figure out when we're making progress and when we're not. That leads to my questions. Do you feel like year over year, over the last 24, 36 months, whatever time horizon General Austin makes sense to you, does ISIS control more or less territory, or do they have greater or less influence in other areas that are emerging as potential strongholds for ISIS in the future, more or less?
Less in Iraq.
What's the net? Because we know they're expanding elsewhere. We know they're changing jerseys in Afghanistan from Al-Qaeda and other groups and Taliban into ISIS. We've got them operating in other areas. So what's the net, more or less?
It would be more if you consider...
Okay. Do they have, if you were to compare their resources, their economic resources over the last 24 or 36 months, do they have more or less dollars to support their terrorist operations?
Less. We have targeted their resources. They make money, as you know, Senator, off things like oil collection.
Antiquity sales, kidnappings.
Right. And so we have long, I have said on a number of occasions, not only do we have to stop the flow of foreign fighters, but we have to take away this enemy's ability to finance.
Okay. Another measure. I'm trying to come up with this concept of a dashboard so that when we have the next committee hearing meeting, I can ask you the same series of questions and see where the trends are. Do they have more or less influence? They seem to be winning on social media in terms of reaching out to people in the homeland, reaching out to people in Europe. About 6 hours ago, it was posted that some 15-year-old girl murdered her mother in Europe. Was convicted of murder as a result of being radicalized by some of the social media presence. Have we stemmed the tide on their continued expansion of the use of social media to radicalize people internationally and in the homeland?
I think they do have a more effective counter-messaging campaign at this point. Yeah. That's an area we need to work on.
And it seems to be growing. It seems like, again, in terms of trends, the ground that they're taking, the places they're heavily influencing, social media... I mean, this is an organization that is trending in the wrong direction against the greatest superpower that's ever existed. I want to go back to chemical weapons. Do you think that there's been reports? I only want to talk about confirmed reports. Do you think that their use of chemical weapons have increased over the last 24 months, or that are beginning to see evidence that they're being used in certain areas in Syria and Iraq? More or less?
Senator, given that they had no apparent use of chemical weapons at the outset, there have been some indications.
Okay. And then the last question I have is how we're working. I understand that most of the problem has to deal with the fact that Iraq has failed to do what they need to do to engage the Sunni population, but they haven't done it. So over the course of the last 24, 36 months, has the Sunni population been more or less inclined to side with ISIS where the conflicts are arising in Iraq?
I think we've seen considerable outreach from Prime Minister Abadi to the Sunni community. There are now 4,000 Sunni tribal fighters in Anbar that we didn't have 6 months ago.
So you feel like we're winning in terms of engaging the hearts and minds of the Sunni population?
I think we're bringing more Sunni tribal fighters into the fight.
Okay,
I would agree that they're less inclined to in Iraq to side with ISIL. They've seen what ISIL brings to the table, and most of the Sunnis don't want that going forward. But they do want to be included in the government of Iraq. So.
And I think that they should be if we're going to have a long-term strategy that has productive engagement. Thank you very much. I'm sorry, Ranking Member, for going over my time.
Thank you, Senator Till. Senator King has requested an additional question. Senator King. And
not a question, Mr. Chairman. I want to submit for the record an extraordinary speech by Robert Gates in 1992 when he was head of the CIA on the danger of the politicization of intelligence. It's prescient and brilliant, which is not surprising coming from Robert Gates, and I just want to submit it for the record. Thank you.
Without objection, so ordered. On behalf of Chairman McCain, let me thank the witnesses and adjourn the hearing. Thank you.